When you leave your house in France and come to the United States, when you leave your adopted home and come to your real home, mm-hmm. what kind of response do you have inside yourself?
I miss my family.
Mm-hmm.
I miss a lot of people, you know, who are part of me.
Keep you alive.
No.
Yes.
And a certain kind of speed, energy, beat, which only American black people have.
I know.
No. I miss that. And you say my home, it's not exactly my home. It's a kind of asylum. It's a place where I can work. I have a lot of work to do. And if you are in a situation where you're always resisting and resenting, it's very hard to...
It takes too much energy.
Well, you can't write a book.
No.
You can't write a sentence.
No.
And I asked my brother David, we were driving through Harlem the other day. I was in Harlem, I was living there. And I said to him, I wonder what would happen to me if I'd stayed. And you know David.
I know David.
Because, I mean, you know, because I also wanted to stay. You know, I didn't,
yes,
want, to, I didn't want to go. David laughed. That laugh.
That terrible, laugh. Knowing laugh.
He said, you'd be dead. Everybody else is.
That's right. And you look around at your friends long dead. Lost.
Well, David is 43. I'm 50.
That's
none
something.
Of us, neither,
but,
neither
about
of
about
us know.
About being 50.
About being 50?
Yes, but that's coming. Good, good.
Neither of us know anybody our age. My nephew, my oldest nephew, who's 27, knows one person his age. Baby, this is a high-priced country.
You, your family is closely knit.
I'm a very lucky cat.
You're very lucky. I find myself very lucky because I've been adopted into that family. So I find
that's
myself...
That's actually, you marched into it. You pained my mother, I saw
I took it, didn't I?
You did.
I'm going to talk about mother in a while.
Go on.
But what does the family feel about you living in South of France? I mean, living away from them without, say, an arm reach, distance, an arm out of
sweetheart,
arm reach.
You have to understand... you have to understand what happens to my mother's telephone when I'm in town. The people who call her up and say what they will do to me, if she doesn't make me shut up. You also got to remember that I've been writing, after all, between assassinations. And if you were my mother or my brother, you would think, who's next?
That's Mama.
It's extraordinary. The woman raised 9 children, and you, every one of them, the difference between me and George, the difference between me and David, the difference between me and...
You and Wilma.
And Willie. And all 5 girls. And though she was scared to death... Oh, no, really. No, really, really scared to death.
You mean of your father?
No, scared to death of what was going to happen to us.
Yes, yes.
Because she knew something we didn't know.
Because you couldn't then.
And there we went.
Yeah.
And she never blackmailed us.
Yes.
And she just, you know, I went to Paris in 1948. It was a rainy day. Mama came downstairs like that. Paula was upstairs. Paula was 5 years old, a baby. And I can't explain to a baby, you know, why you have to do what you have to do. And she wouldn't talk to me and she was crying. My mother. The taxi drove away. But she let me go. I think at bottom she knew how much, maybe she knew better than I did, how much I loved them. And I didn't want her to see me turn into a junkie.
Right.
No.
A prostitute. In any way.
No, many, many ways.
Right.
Go to jail, because nobody could call me nigger. I'd done the post office bit. I'd worked for the army. I'd been up and down those streets.
Yep.
So now I had 5 minutes. And I had to jump to save my family.
And they let you
that come. Sounds very grandiose.
No, but I know, because I do know a story. I know that when you went to France, that with Mother Baldwin, with all those children, that from time to time, one of the lovely stories about your family is that from time to time, David and George, or the older boys, would work with coal in the winter, ice in the summer, selling, and on welfare, whatever, aid to just something kinds of families, and still would manage sometimes to send you a little check.
Oh, I remember.
In France. I mean, to think of a black American family in Harlem who had no pretensions to great literature and so forth as such. Great literature. Mm-hmm. And to have the oldest boy leave home and go to Paris, France, and then for them to save up enough pennies and nickels and dimes to send a check of $150 to him in
that's
Paris,
what people,
France.
But that's what people don't really know about us.
One of the things I think, I mean, I believe that we are Americans. It is true.
You believe it?
Well,
I know it.
We are black Americans. We have our feet, our souls, our hearts in.
We have paid for this country.
Absolutely.
That's why I can never leave it, by the way.
I know. No. Never. That's a lovely thing about.
At least I never deluded myself into thinking that.
About that line that you can't go home again. You can't even leave.
You can't leave home. You can't leave home. You carry it with you.
Of course. No. And then create a whole atmosphere.
There are no Harlem barbershops. There are beautiful barbershops in Paris. They know Harlem barbershop in Paris.
No, I know. A beauty shop where you can hear who's doing what to whom at what time. And what.
There's not that speed, that beat, that fire, you know. I owe my adopted country, as you put it, a lot, because it left me alone.
Yes. And when French people or Europeans ask you about your country, about the United States of America, or as I constantly say on anywhere, it's what James Baldwin calls it, these yet-to-be United States of America. Jim, what is your response to the question?
I had to go to Germany for the publication of Beale Street. I was working very hard somewhere in Paris, in fact, in libraries and doing research, right? You know. And I wanted to cancel the tour because I was into what I was, you know, into my thing. I was doing.
In your groove.
And I didn't want to, you know. I got back home to St. Paul and discovered that the USIS. The tour was for 5 German cities. And the USIS had broken its contract with my German publisher, saying that the US Information Service is not here to publicize novels and novelists.
How had they had the contract in the first place?
Well, in the normal way, you know, the publisher, the German publisher, or the French publisher,
right.
For that matter,
right.
You know, if you come to your town, and you're an American writer,
right.
You know, it's a kind of courtesy to the American embassy.
Uh-huh, I see.
And they broke the contract. And this was all over the German press. In effect, I was being banned by my own government. That's not the end of the story. I called my poor brother, David, who just left, and said, you better come back.
David, come.
come and take me to Germany. Because once I was banned, I had to go.
Of course. You had no choice.
I had to go.
Of course.
And I went. Now, this is on German soil, right? And I was in a very difficult position because the Germans wanted to say how much better they were than the Americans.
To blacks, yes, and to you in particular.
And so I had to say, you got to remember,
1939.
You got to remember it all started in Europe. That's how we got America. And I know this was the Third Reich, you know, and I'm not going to let you congratulate yourselves about the disastrous performance in my own country, because I know your performance too.
That's right. And in Africa. In Lomé.
As far as our celebrated Negro problem is concerned, you know, if you really want to know what that is, look out the window. Look out your window right now and see who's sweeping your streets. You call it the foreign worker problem. We call it slave labor.
They're Italians and Arabs.
We left them fighting with each other.
Tim, I tell you, your life. There are a million questions I have to ask, and I have to ask you to direct yourself to some what they call heavy. Young people have, especially young whites, have found that word, and they attach it to anything.
They found the word beat.
Yeah. You said something. A man had a question to you about homosexuality.
Oh, yeah.
And you had a response to it. And I would like to hear it again and again and again.
I said, it's a weary, weary, weary question. I said, homosexual is not a noun. It might be a verb, transitive. It is certainly an adjective, but it is not a noun. To ask the question means you don't know anything about human experience, where it can take you, what it can do. You know, and if you categorize the world in that way, then you lock yourself out from so much. I know boys, I swear to you, sweetheart. I know cats, I'm talking about white cats now too, football player types who went on the needle. Went on the needle and finally died because they're afraid somebody would call them a faggot. Well, all I know about human life, I don't know much.
Less and less?
Yes, when I was young, I knew a lot. Now I don't know nothing, which is a great relief. But but I know all I know about human life is if I love you, I love you. And if I love you and duck it, I die.
Exactly. Exactly. But you see, out of that, I think, is, for me, I see the nature of love, the ability to dare, to challenge despair, and to dare to love.
You can't prophesy it. You can't say, you cannot make a decision like I'm going to fall in love with,
June the
girl
43rd,
that I marry. Right. All that Tin Pan Alley jazz, right? You don't know. And you have to trust life.
Ah.
You have to trust life.
Ah. And when you say trust life, of course, that means all of it.
Yes,
the whole.
All of it.
Okay, then what does that mean about death? I mean,
about
how?
Death?
About death. If one trusts life, is death not in that circumference?
Well, I think, you know, that the only way to live is know you're going to die. If you're afraid to die, you'll never be able to live.
Hey, hey.
You know?
Hey, hey.
And nobody knows anything about death.
Yes.
No.
Yes. Yes.
And that's just, and that is also just another word.
The thing in the blue. Death is another word.
We don't know
word.
Anything about
right.
it. You know?
Right.
When I go, I'll go. And where I'm going, I don't know. And it might be, you know, beautiful. It might be nothing. It might be, you know, I think it's a cycle.
I do.
No.
I agree.
I trust my ancestors. Well, I know, however this may sound, I know what happens to me when I'm in trouble. I know what my mother taught me, which was to love everybody.
Yep.
And when I'm in trouble, I listen to something. When I'm writing, I'm listening to something.
Yeah.
Because, you know, all this bit about being a writer or being a star and all of that. The truth is, you become a writer because a day comes in your life, you have to accept that. You have to accept the fact that you're not a truck driver.
Yes.
You know,
even if you loved it.
A ditch digging. I've done, I ain't never driven a truck, but I can still dig a ditch. That is, it's a division of labor in the world. Some people can do this.
Yes.
Some people can do that.
That's right.
And the people who reduced you, which is what I mean by my ancestors. I'm a kind of poet, and I come out of a certain place, a certain time, a certain history.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And the people who produced me, whether or not they always loved me or liked me,
they produced
you. They produced me because...
And you are the total of that.
And that is my gig.
Right. Jim, recently, you had a 50th birthday.
Oh, yeah, I'm 50 years old. Isn't that astounding?
And beautiful.
I don't believe that.
I don't either, but I mean, you've made a statement
don't
about
believe.
It. What do you think about being 50?
Well, I said to you, it seems very unfair because, you're dealing with numbers, right?
Right.
I'm 20 years away from 30.
Yeah, not bad.
And I'm 20 years away from 70.
Not bad.
Now, that seems a little unfair. Unfair in the sense that, all right, here we go. You can't go back.
Yeah.
It's 20 years, between 30 and 50 and 20 to 50 and 70. Which means for me, finally, that I will have to hang around a while.
And it also means that you're closer, you said, to 70 than
you were. Oh, I'm much closer to 70 than I am to 50. But something else happens to you when you realize that. Something else happens to you. You realize that now you got to use the time. You got to use the time. I ain't gonna live another 50 years. Given my temperament and my stubbornness, I might live another 30 years. No, all bets are off.
Right.
But it does mean you gotta use the time.
Could you stay alive, vital and productive, without your family?
No. No way. No way. If I didn't know that was at my back.
Yes.
The net. I'm on a tightrope.
Right.
Ain't no net on a tightrope. Each time out, it's
you're
higher.
Out there.
It's higher. Now, you gotta got a certain safety. We really have a certain safety because we love each other.
Okay, let me just ask you this. How do you cope with success and after that, if you want to weave them together, it's fine with me. How do you cope with despair? Despair in front of the fact that the world is saying you're a success. Okay?
I think, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in my own case, in a paradoxical fashion, which I can't possibly explain, what is called success in my own case, right? What came out of despair?
Of course.
No.
Of course. Life out of death, death out of life.
That's how you learn to live with despair.
Mm.
If you live with despair, success, I must say, is a little like finding yourself on a runaway horse, because you never see it coming. And also, in a very serious way. It is not possible for an artist to be a success.
Hmm.
No.
Then would you say that again?
I said it is not possible for an artist to be a success.
Thank you.
Once you think of yourself as a success,
you're finished.
You forget
Benito.
It.
Because you know what I find? Is that you begin to believe your own publicity.
You begin to take your identity from other
from something
people.
Else, and you stop experimenting because somebody says, well, when you did so-and-so, that was such a success. Why don't you do that again?
Look, when I wrote Hotel on the Mountain, which is, God help us, 1952. Mm. I am 50. But I knew something. It's very hard to describe. I knew Engotten Matt was a success.
Oh,
you
yes.
know, young man's success, you know.
Right.
Young man's book. And every, you know, everybody fell in love with me. I was, I was going to be the great new folklore hero. But I thought, no, I'm a writer. I'm not going to write Go Tell It on the Mountain again.
73 times. Go Tell It on the Mountain Return.
So I did a play, which I knew nobody would do, The Amen Corner.
The Amen Corner, yeah.
Put it in my trunk for years and years.
11 years, in fact.
In fact.
Before it was produced.
Mm-hmm. Put it in my trunk, you know. One of my finger exercises. I was not going to write another novel.
Right.
At that moment. And then in Giovanni's room, very much as a finger exercise, too, and also in order to confront something I had to deal with in myself. Because one of the dangers of being a black American, and certainly a black American man, is there's such a complex of ambiguities to deal with, you know, such a complex of poses, you know.
Right. Roles to play.
And I had to... I've been playing a certain role.
Mm.
I was a stud, you know, and I didn't want to drown there neither, you know, and I wanted to figure out to tell the truth to myself.
Yeah.
About where it is, you know, what is it? This male, female, man, woman, black, white.
Right, up, down.
You know? And I had to try to deal with that. Well...
So Giovanni's Room came out of
well,
that.
Well, what it comes to is that I wrote Mountain. I wrote Amen Corner, forget it. I wrote The Notes of a Native Son, forget it. It was a remainder.
Mm-hmm.
Giovanni's Room was a certain kind of hit because nobody believed the man who wrote Hotel on the Mountain
could also
write
or
Giovanni's
would.
Room.
Not
or
only
would.
Could, but would. Now, there are those who say Giovanni's Room until another, that was one of your greatest and most perfect books.
A book is always flawed.
I know.
And the writer knows it better than the critics do. He knows where the flaws are.
Long before.
You know? And you become a writer by... I wrote Go Tell on the Mountain about God knows how many times. But you need to accept the fact that, all right, this is not Hamlet. It ain't The Brothers Karamazov.
Huh?
Which have been written already, by the way.
And well...
This is... me, no. And if you don't, you know, at a certain point you cut the performance off, and you got to get it out of the house, so
and
you can start again.
Is there any time in life when you start a project that you're not afraid?
Scared.
Scared.
I tell you about No Name in the Street, which was, after all was written between assassinations. I rewrote it. I finally, as I say in the end of the book, I had to reconcile myself to the fact that I was never going to be able to finish it. Because it was not a journalistic assignment. It was something I had to do. It was involved with all the headlines, you know. It was a very public, you know, in a sense, document dealing with
right.
a lot of public events. I finished it. As I put it on my desk, my brother David came to see me, because David always knows that I'm in trouble. And he read it. Came down to the office and he read the book. Didn't say a word. Went back upstairs. And he said, have you mailed it yet? I said, no. So he went upstairs.
This is in St. Paul?
In St. Paul.
De Vance,
in
southern Paul
de Vance,
France.
South okay. of France, in the hills.
Right.
The next morning he came downstairs and looked at me, picked up the book, and he said, ain't you got no envelopes?
Mail it off.
And he mailed it.
Mail it off.
He mailed it. Because he knew there's a moment, you know, after all, I don't want to go into this really, but, you know, I loved Malcolm and... Mm. He got his head blown off, right? I loved Medgar, he got his head blown off, you know, and Martin got his head blown off. And I'd worked with Bobby Kane, and I'd worked with a little bit of JFK, and oh, have mercy. Wow, you know. What, ain't nothing I've done, you know, to type out the keys, which saved nobody. And it took me a very long time. That's why I ended up in the hospital.
I know.
It took me a very long time to reconcile myself to trying to be a writer again, because one is always trying to be a writer. I don't care what the world says.
I know that.
No.
That's like trying one to be a good Christian,
one is
a
trying.
Good Jew, a good Muslim,
one
a,
is
a
trying.
Poet. Every, if time. You're 80, you get up and you try to make that fit you again.
That's right.
Yeah. That cloak you
That's
put
right.
down last
That's
night.
Right.
Exactly. Well, I have no argument.
What David did really was point out to me in his laconic fashion that I had to keep the faith.